online learning. For smaller liberal arts college, we do have just a large number of digital humanists who are really bringing it into their classrooms. Right? We have an NEH grant for a course called Computing for Poets. They're doing real text mining with Python, and these are mostly English language doing that. We also are institutional partners in the Tapas project, which is about building a repository for TI documents. So we have digital humans doing this sort of active technical learning with students who may start from a place of resistance to those things. And their work is very much focused on that kind of project. We also have a lot of folks doing visual storytelling work, multimedia production, having students make podcasts and videos and so on. A great example of that is our Watson Conversations series. It's all done through a couple of our history classes where students are making podcasts in response to a work of art. And then that podcast is going on to a growing collection of these along with the images for the artwork that they're responding to. And that is something that just lives on our history site and is there for people to find. We have a growing number of people interested in mobile learning, iPads. We have a number of iPads that we lend out for field work, but also this multimedia production stuff. And we do have a maker space, which is located in CompSci, but embodies this idea of reaching out to students who aren't technically inclined, getting them to make stuff. So it's focused on 3D printing. We've expanded it to include a fiber space within wearable clothing and wearable computing and that kind of stuff. And the red thread in all of this is something like information fluency, something like, in addition to these content outcomes, what skills-based outcomes can students be getting from the way that an assignment or course is done? So if a student can learn audio production in addition to learning all the content they learn from examining and analyzing a work of art, that's great. That fits with our goals as an institution. We've also had to think about, well, what are our existing structures of support? How can we use these to support blended learning? We are a merged library technology group. My team that I serve on is the research and instruction team. It's half technologists and half librarians. So we have librarians who are doing a lot of teaching and have a very particular and I think useful perspective on teaching and technology. Having been in that position, I can say it's very eye-opening the range of technical skills students actually have and the things that they'll have trouble with despite being completely facile with design, right? And they're not afraid to let us know that they're having trouble in the same way maybe, because we're not grading them for whatever reason. And so we have a real useful perspective on that. We also have our own curriculum. We go into every first year seminar and we have what we think of as a skunk works. We think of it as a space to try things out. We started trying out blended learning stuff in the FYS context so that we're working with FYS with a large number of faculty across all disciplines. So we're sort of, in a way, disseminating these ideas through that context. But then we also have our liaisons going on to other courses throughout the curriculum. And we have the space to say, okay, let's try something new this time. Right? There's a lot of openness to that. And then we also have these internal grants for teaching with technology. They're focused on innovation. I think we fund about 6 to 10 of them a semester. We fund as many as we have money for. Those tend to be equipment focused. Sometimes they're about buying student worker time, but they all culminate in this internal dissemination and the brown bag, right? And so it creates this culture of teaching with technology as neat stuff, right? As a place to try new things. And there's a lot of energy around that experimentation. So in this context, where our conversations about technology often come back, pedagogy, we've been thinking of blended learning as a pedagogical solution that has other benefits, right? I think earlier was mentioned that a lot of the interest in blended learning and online learning starts from an efficiency standpoint. And we're sort of thinking, well, it might eventually have that, but it has to be a pedagogical solution for it first. We're asking certain questions like, what can we push outside of class time so that we can have more class time for the things that can only happen there, that really high value stuff. And then more complicated questions that fit blended learning into these existing communities of practice and their values and priorities. So how can blended learning be active learning, right? How can blended learning be project-based learning? And then, you know, maybe in the biggest question, at least for this presentation, is what does a blended assignment look like in the context of what we're already doing? So by way of example, just this semester, I was approached by an English professor teaching the methods course, and she wanted to transform an assignment she'd been teaching for years in which students used MLA International Bibliography to assemble a critical reception history of Wuthering Heights. And the goal of this assignment is to see how temporal and constructed literary criticism itself is, because the reception of Wuthering Heights in 1880 is very different from the reception even in 1930, let alone today. And so they get that, that important information literacy training and learning how to use MLA International Bibliography and other related resources that work for this assignment. But they were, in the original iteration, just writing a paper from this. And she came to me and she said, I would like to make this more of a way of introducing them to digital humanities concepts. And also, I would like to make this more blended. So I'm newly in this position that's about blended learning, and I see this opportunity I have to build something that can serve as an example for other faculty. And so what we decided to do is, instead of having them write a paper, we have them as a group contribute to a timeline of the reception over time. So we divided them into groups, assigned them to individual decades between the publication date and the present, and had them train them on MLA, and had them go out and find all the citations they could within their decade, right? Then they came back, we talked about digital humanities methodologies, the idea of distant reading versus close reading, right? What you can get out of distant reading as opposed to the close reading that they've mostly been trained to do up to this point in their major. And we trained them how to contribute to a digital timeline. And the timeline itself was actually based in JSON. It's a tool called Timeline.js, and I can recommend it generally. One of the nice things about it is that the students don't have to learn JSON, they don't have to do any coding to contribute to this neat-looking timeline, but all they have to do is field out their data into a Google spreadsheet. It hooks up to Google Drive. And as an organization that uses Google Apps, that's even simpler for us because the students already are just using the login they already have, right? To get in. And I built a website that supported this process for them, gave them resources for the research. We talked a lot about the research component as really being about metadata, right? So why is this article showing up in the search? Well, the answer is in the record, right? If you look in a database record, you have everything you need to know, literally everything the database knows about that article or book is in that record, sort of getting them to think in that systems way. And then they came back in the class, they populated the timeline very smoothly. That's where we were expecting the most trouble, the students sort of writing late on a Sunday night saying, I can't get my citations displayed. There's no such issue, great. And then what we got in class was this sort of class presentation that involved everybody, right? So everybody was both a contributor and an audience for the discussion we had using this timeline. Each had their sort of area of expertise, and then we had them choose their three most representative citations from their decade as a small group. So they made some sort of curatorial choices about what went on there and why. And then to the group, they said why. Here's what we chose and why. Here are the trends we saw and so on. And we did a little bit of other data visualizations with the subject headings we found in the databases. So what are the subject headings for Wuthering Heights in the 60s versus the And that is for the website itself. Maybe if we have time in the Q&A, I can show you the time. So they're getting two kinds of outcomes, right? Learning outcomes. They're getting the ones, they're asking the questions in discussion and the processes. Well, they're going to making the tools and curating the tools. So why these things and not others, right? Why these three citations when we have 20 others to choose from? What makes these representative? Why these three together? Are you covering some sort of breadth by choosing these particular groups? And they're getting to these sort of information fluency outcomes. They're thinking about field of data with the spreadsheet. They're thinking about how systems are built and so on. And it became a very gentle way to introduce them to digital humanities without taking on actual programming, which, as we know, we can take a full course for. But then they also have the chance to use the tools. So when it's their turn in the discussion, where they're not the group that's explaining the choices, they ask these questions like, how do we see these things? What questions arise from this? The sort of typical questions we might think of as the content question. It's more about critical thinking and curatorial thinking, right? And that goes towards the content things. So I mentioned that this approach has been a popular a way of getting in with humanists and social scientists. And just as an example of that, just this month, we awarded 8 grants for course transformation blendLAC. It was disseminated to the whole faculty. 7 of those 8 are humanists or social scientists. And 6 of those 7, I believe, include assignments like this. Now, that's not mutually exclusive to all the other stuff we're talking about today. Using quizzes and using the real tools and whatnot. They're doing things like online office hours and so on. But they're using this logic of making tools and using tools, right? Information fluency and content fluency. So just some of the ones that we have in the works, we have stuff with map annotation. We have our history professor who is really focused on museum studies, and she's building a whole assignment out of the idea of provenance and tracking items from where they started and where they ended up and whether or not that jives with the ESCO and whatnot, and that being the basis for presentations and discussion. We have folks doing multimedia production and going back to sort of those communities of practice with the women's studies class that is the capstone. They're going to go to different nonprofits and Providence and southeastern Massachusetts area and gather media from these folks, interviews, and so on, and build a map, like a resource map, of nonprofits focused on women's issues that could, that has the potential to just be a resource for people in the area. Becomes sort of a service learning kind of thing as well. So that's what we have in the works. I would love to show you guys a timeline if we have time, but I want to give Professor Torres a chance to do her. For part of the presentation, so maybe during the Q&A we can come back with
it. I am just gonna load up my presentation. And start by telling you that actually what I am going to talk about today is not what I used the grant for at all. What I used the grant for was actually very similar to what many people were talking about, adding assessment to a course that's not this course that I'm mostly going to talk about. So just so that you know, that the aspect of blended learning that I'm working on is not the aspect that I think I am very comfortable doing. So the course that I'm going to primarily talk about is a upper level seminar in anthropology, sociology, and women's studies. It is a violence against women course. And in this course, because it's an upper level seminar, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get my students to actually develop a number of skill sets that I hope that in my earlier courses and in my colleagues' courses, they would have begun to develop. So one of the key things is the practical application of theory. So the practical application of high theory. Responsible engagement. So in anthropology, we begin with the idea of public responsible engagement from the very beginning, from the intro to anthro course, where, you know, despite what my colleagues in English, the trepidations that they might have, we force our students to write online publicly so that they can learn that writing matters, because anthropology started as a public discipline, a discipline that wanted to do good, right? So this is, so we want to emphasize public curation, responsible engagement, purposeful communication, and research writing, all with online tools, so all with digital tools. I've done this in a number of courses in the introduction to anthropology, in the senior seminar of anthropology where they write a research thesis, and we also include online objects, but particularly in the violence against women class where they design their own project. So let me tell you a little bit about what we did in this class. This class is a very traditional seminar for half of the course, where we read anthropological theory about social suffering, about pain, where we look at sociological studies on statistical analysis of both US and global rates of violence against women, where we look at how we define data sets in this, where we look at how anthropologists themselves deal with issues of violence that arise in their field work, what they deal with, what they do when the violence happens to them. So we look at theory at a very high level in this course, and that's what we do for the first half of the course. The second half of the course follows feminist pedagogy, where we say, okay, we've learned the theory, it's been depressing, do something. You live in a community that has very high rates of violence against women. The United States is a place that has very high rates of violence against women. Not compared to some others, but actually rates that I find unacceptable and that my students find unacceptable. So if we find unacceptable that there are rapes that happen on our campus every semester, then what do we do on our campus that applies the theory that we've learned in this course to change our campus and the way that we think? So it's a project. So as a class, my students have to develop a project that addresses the issue of violence against women in some way, that educates their cohort on issues of violence against women in some way. And we spend significant amount of class time doing it. How do we do this on campus? And because many of them exist heavily online, we always use digital technology. So for this course, what we did is we chose what theory do we want to apply. So we looked at a theorist whose name is Vina Das. And Vina Das does work on social suffering. And what she does in one of her papers that we had a chance to read and discuss in the first part of the term is she talks about the social suffering that's accompanied the post-rape period. So when women are raped, they feel that they are changed human beings. This is Vina Das's assessment of it. And they feel that they are unable to reintegrate into society in the way that they've been changed, that that's not recognized. So this was the theoretical point that my students wanted to apply to a consciousness raising project on campus. The way that they thought they would do this is that they would leverage social networks. So this became a project that was driven heavily by Facebook. And so when they made that choice in terms of the venue, I said, okay, well, if we're going to be doing this on Facebook, we have to learn some theory about how social networks work. So then we brought in new material, we read the material, and we said, okay, how do social networks work? How do anthropologists that study social networks, how do they say it works? Well, they tend to say that they work in reaffirming online interaction, reaffirms offline interaction, and vice versa, right? So we said, okay, that's a principle that we can think of and try and see if it works like that. The other thing that they say is that online interactions can be really good at galvanizing offline interactions. So how do we create a campus that's open to talking about violence against women, which is a downer topic? So how do we create a campus of teenagers that will talk about violence against women? And this is one of the things that we developed. So we developed a strategy to get people to talk about it in a way that they didn't find, that they found kind of cool, right? So then the students said, let's try and think about the profile picture, right? What could we do to get people to talk about violence against women through the profile picture? How could we get people to change their profile picture to something that has to do with violence against women, right? And so they said, well, if we want to change the profile picture, it has to have really high production value. So the beginning ones have to look really good. It has to look like ads, because if they don't look like ads, nobody's going to want to change their profile picture to this. So we created a set of really high value. They found the photographers. They had an idea of what high value was in terms of production, and they put it together. The idea was, write something on your hand that is the first word you think about when you think of the issue of violence against women. And so all the members of our class, it was a class of 36, all the members of our class changed their profile pictures to this. And there was demand. We created a web page where we were talking about violence against women's issues. And so when people changed their profile pictures, they said, go to this web page. And the pictures looked good, and people are very ego-oriented. They wanted to talk about it. So we were asked by other students, can you have like a picture-taking time that we could come and get our pictures done just like this so we could change our profile pictures? And so we did this. By the end of the time that we were done this, we had half the campus, including administrators, professors, and students, having changed their profile picture for a period of time to something like this. And so we had engaged them into talking about violence against women in a not offensive way. But that was just the beginning, because what we wanted is we wanted to begin a conversation. And so then we began a series of information sessions. We began a series of information sessions that we would then replicate online. We did videos that we also put online on Facebook through Twitter. And we had an event that was a post-secret event. So I don't know if you know anything about post-secret. I certainly didn't know anything about it before I started teaching this class. My students said, one of the social networking tools that we sometimes use to get people to talk about things is post-secret, where people can post secretly, anonymously, something. So we could use this as a way for people to tell their secrets about violence against women that has happened in their life. And to do so in a way that doesn't name anyone, but talks about the issue. And then also brings the social network in. And then we had an event where we shared the secrets that were part of our experience. So this is one of the ways that actually what we're doing is we're making culture, leveraging online. We're changing the way that our students feel about violence against women. So it used to be, when I first started working on this, that in our campus, when someone talked about issues of violence against women, they were called a feminist in a not complimentary way. And I have seen in the last 2 years a significant change in that. Significant change in the way that students relate to this. It has also had significant impact in that we've just recently as an institution received the Department of Justice grant based in part on what we've been doing in our curriculum on violence against women. It's a $300,000 grant to have faculty collaboration across the discipline. So we have CS involved, we have theater involved, we have the social sciences involved to develop curricular materials. So we have a data visualization component, we have a theater production component, all to develop violence against women materials that can be used in our campus and that then we can share. Right. And so we're leveraging it for a number of reasons, but what do our students get out of it? At the end of this class, I can give very detailed reference letters about how students are able to manage a project. A very clear project with a very clear communications goal. I can talk about their proficiency. Let's say the student that took all the images, I can talk about her proficiency and what kind of an impact. I can actually put numbers to that. I can say this is how many people, this is how many likes we get on something. And that might be sort of insignificant data, but before I had none. Right? It also allows students to really reflect on how they can apply some of the types of knowledge that they might think are irrelevant. And it allows them to feel, and I think this is a really important part of what we are able to do, it allows them to feel that not only did they learn about theory in their course, but that they were able to participate in life. So when we get responses to this course, which leverages online digital technology, what we get from students is that this course is transformative. It has changed how I view life in engaging in it, right? So not using it as an assessment, because I, in some ways, even though I use technology very heavily, I have, that's the assessment part has been very resistant. So how do I assess this work? Well, I told them I was gonna assess in terms of impact. So I'd like to see the Facebook likes. I'd like to see the traffic on the Facebook site. I'd like to see the traffic on the other website. I'd like to see the foot traffic at the events. And I'd like them to get that to happen, right? So as they would, in some ways, I'm the project assessor and they are the project manager. So they have to figure out their own solutions as to how this project is gonna work to get to the results that I want, right? And so I can say that when I write a reference letter for a student, this person was able to meet these expectations in this way, very specifically. So for me, and they were able to use multiple platforms. So it creates in some senses, and students have used it in this way, it creates a kind of a resume that has specific elements that they can point to. This is an example of how I've done this. This is an example of how I've done that. But it also has impact for other faculty. Because as I said, this was a project that went viral on campus. And so when other faculty saw that this is like, we've never talked about this, other people's courses in the lunchroom. And this was a course that people started to talk about in the lunchroom. Then I've gotten repeated requests from other faculty. How did you do this? How did you design the assignment? And how did you assess it? This I assessed through reflexive writing. So students had to reflect on their own learning process, reflect and assess ways to quantify the effectiveness of what they've done. So they had to construct for me, how do I know this is effective? How do I know what I did was effective? And tell me how they would assess it. So they were the ones that pointed, well, I would look at the lights, I would look at how many people came out to the events, I would look at whether or not this changes the way we interact with each other and how would you assess it. So this is just one example of what I do in my course to sort of talk and think about culture, but also to try and get students involved in making culture, which I think we're always doing, whether we like to admit it to ourselves or not. All right, and I think we'll both take questions at this point.
That's brilliant.
Well, the interesting thing is I didn't do it. It's brilliant, and I didn't really have very much to do.
But you created context in which people rose to an occasion.
Absolutely. And when they report how much time they spent on this, they spent an incredible amount of time on this course, much more than any other course that they were taking at the time. And some of them said much more than all three courses, but they wanted to.
If we wanted to spread this, or to at least be able to point our faculty and say, look at this, don't you think you could do something kind of like this? Where would we go?
You could go to Facebook, to Violence Against Women's Symposium.
Okay.
Yep.
And when you see the final product, you don't know all the class process that went into it. So the description of how you...
It has all the elements in it on Facebook. It has all the elements, all the events.
But we can also point them to our friendly camera hands.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, that would be the class process. But the project design was theirs. And I don't have enough knowledge of how student culture works to have come up with an effective design. They had to, you know, it's in anthropology, you have to know your field. I don't know student culture as my field, but they do. And that's why it worked for them. Mm-hmm.
You said that people came to the events. What kind of events did you have?
So we had a Wheaton Secrets event. So in the end, we had about, I think it was about 65 people shared their stories of violence. And it was people across campus, so it was students, but it was also faculty and staff. And they would say, in their secret, they would say, I'm a faculty member, I'm a staff member. And they would share their stories of violence against women. And they did so online. And then we had an event in which, as a community, we responded to the secrets. Because remember the theory? That we wanted to recognize how people had been changed. And so they devised a public event in which we would write back to the people who shared their secrets as a community. And so we spent some time writing together, we spent some time listening to the secrets and acknowledging them, and they ran that themselves.
What technology did you use for that?
Post-secrets. That's what it's called, post-secrets.
Just that one.
Is it a website?
It's a website, mm-hmm. Yeah. Which I didn't know anything about until they brought it to my attention. I gather that they use it to talk about, like, I think if you look at post-secrets, whatever your institution is, you will find many secrets about your institution.
Oh, really?
I didn't know about that.
Have you run this more than once? Is this one semester's worth of work? Or?
This is one semester's. This project is one semester's worth of work. I have run the course before, but I was very hesitant to use online technology. They suggested it at the time, but it's, given that it's such a sensitive issue, at the time I thought, I really don't want to do that. And that was probably a mistake. And this time I was braver. And I was getting closer to tenure, because I think that also matters. and so, in some ways, I think that was why I felt more comfortable engaging in something like this that was so public about my own teaching.
And so how would you do it again? Like, what are your lessons
learned? I'm going to do it again this year coming. Mm-hmm. And I think it has to be student driven. Like, they have to define the project. And this was always part of the course design, that the students define a project, what we call an activist project or a consciousness raising project. Mm-hmm. They have a choice between the two. And so they have to define the project. So we'll see what they come up with next time. They may not want to engage with the online technology. And so sort of my role in that case, when they did decide on this, is let's not go at it blind. Mm-hmm. You know, let's think a little bit about the theory, because anthropologists are very interested in the online space as a cultural space. So there's plenty of anthropologists to draw on for this. So that was my role in sort of shaping that part and sort of bringing them back to, okay, what part of the theory are you applying by doing this, and trying to bring it back to what I know and what I thought the purpose of the course was, rather than letting them get carried away into Facebook likeness, which is their tendency.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask, because I think it is very neat. But did you get a chance to talk about sort of maybe the dark side of Facebook, you know, concerns about confidentiality, the commodification of information, things like that? I mean, you're using Facebook in a good way, but Facebook is perhaps a problematic resource in some ways, too.
So this was the debates that we had at the beginning when we were deciding on which platforms we were going to use. So we had active debates as to whether or not we should use Facebook or not Facebook, whether we should use Twitter or not Twitter, and what were the advantages and disadvantages to each for what we wanted to do. So that was part of the debate. You know, as it would happen in any workplace where you're choosing a platform, you know, or a learning management system, you do the assessment. So I could see them learning to do the assessment, and they were checking each other because they wanted the project to go well. Because if you're going to do this in your own profile, you want other people not to think that you are a crazy feminist. Right, and that's what was a big concern for a lot of them, right? Because this was at a time where in our campus, there had been an incident, and the campus had really radicalized. So they wanted to make sure that it was appealing, but also informative. So they were managing stuff. And so it was really good to have those conversations, and that's what we devoted our class time is to having the conversations about what happens. And actually all the work happened outside of class, but our class time was me managing the conversations as to which choices, how do we manage the project as it's going along. That's what